Hey, right, Richard Solomon. I got everybody in the studio. I got Seth, Peter, Dennis, Epi, and we're gonna just yak. Okay, so everybody wants to tell all these great stories about the past and music and WLIR.
I want Dennis to tell the story about when he lived in Roslyn, and he was going to 7-Eleven, and what time of night was it, Dennis?
Which story is this? Oh, okay. I'm new on WLIR. No, I'm coming in, and it's a few weekends after I started, and I'm listening, and it's about it's about 6:30 in the morning, and where I used to drive from the city out, there was a 7-Eleven where I'd stop and get coffee before I'd come up and go on the air. So as I'm listening, you know, we used to run these public affairs shows. And, you know, some guy be talking about something that was supposed to fulfill the public affairs requirement Sunday morning, and then I would resume music programming. Anyway, as we're getting closer to 7-Eleven, the show ends, and I start hearing... and... I'm like,
I know that was, can I guess?
Oh, yeah.
Was that the needle at the end of the record?
That was the needle at the end of the record. I'm thinking, the needle at the end of the record. All right, well, they'll probably catch it. I go in and get the coffee. The radio station's on at 7-Eleven. I'm hearing, I get back in the car. I'm thinking, I better move my ass. I'm not far away from the station. I'm like 5 minutes away. So I zoom in there. I go running up. And the DJ, the overnight guy, is passed out on the floor. And sure enough, there's a record there going, because it's at the end of where the needle goes. And I said, yo, man, we're off the air. You know, and the guy just like instantly woke up and put on the next public affairs show and did a legal ID. And he went, sorry, man. Didn't mean that to happen. I'm like, what the hell kind of radio station is this? So, but yeah, that's the story. That was a good one.
Is there any truth to the myth or the rumor that Inna Gotta DaVita was the bathroom record because it was like 19 minutes and 2 seconds, and if someone was in the studio alone, it gave them enough time to exit the studio, go to the bed, and come back?
There were a number of those.
Yeah.
You know what? I thought the Doors and the Allman Brothers were used much more than the Gotta DaVita because, you know, the Allmans, when you think about it, Memory Elizabeth Reed,
yeah.
And if you wanted, you could even do the mountains, you know, the mountain stuff from the Edie Peach. But the other one, Hendrix, was very big for that because he had some jams on Ladyland and stuff where it would just segue. And the Doors, I believe, were the ones used the most. When the music's over, turn out the lights, you know, or whatever like that. Those were good for really, you could go out, get a sandwich, come back, you know, go take care of some business, and then go back on the air. But Inna Gotta DaVita, those songs were, you know, they used to call them bathroom songs.
Yeah,
but they
yeah.
were songs where, you know, when you played the original version, especially some of those songs had drum solos. Remember, you know, you could play Cream and Toad and stuff like that. You could put a 20-minute drum solo, I would never do it, but there was a time where people called up and they really wanted that 20-minute, you know, play Moby Dick by Led Zeppelin or whatever.
So,
but you know.
So I have a question, guys. All those imports that you got, where did you get them? And you know, and what happens after you play an import?
Well, look, you know, rather than me answer it, look who I found in the studio here. This is Seth Rudman, who used to help us bring in the imports. Okay, Seth, so how did it
work? We need that behind the scenes. So how'd you find them?
It was an extremely exciting time. I lived in London at the time, and we would be getting new records or test pressings of new records that were soon to be released, and we would send them over to Dennis for listening in.
Yeah,
be playing
yeah, it was cool. And you know what? And then I went over and met you.
That's right.
And the fact that we talk about this in the movie, Low Income Radio was what LIR stood for. LIR, Low Income Radio. And They didn't have the money to pay for me to go over, so you'd fly me over as a courier.
Like, no luggage.
$50 you go to London, no luggage. Yep. Yeah. And I get off and sign for this package I'd carry. And then I'd go to his house where my clothes were conveniently shipped, and then we would ship them out of there. That was pretty cool, though.
But it was an exciting time. It was. I mean,
remember, we went to every label. I was treated like a king over there compared to the way, a record company's here. Oh, I don't know. We'll see you sometime. Don't worry about it. There, it's like, oh, please come by and meet the president right away. You know, it was really amazing.
Well, eventually they caught wind, and the U.S. Subsidiaries or U.S. partners of these labels started getting a little pissed off that Dennis was playing stuff a little early.
Yeah. But you know what? You couldn't stop it because it was coming in. It wasn't a copyright infringement. And basically, we couldn't wait for them. You know, people think that started with us. The Beatles. All of those first Beatles singles were released on the record company that didn't have the rights to them here because they were too slow to act. Capitol had the options. Instead, they went to all these little labels like Tolly and, you know, Brian Epstein. You look at it. He was a brilliant, whoever led him to doing that. Every single indie they went to had a number one record, whether it was VJ Records or Tolly Records. All these record companies that eventually got bought by majors because they had hits off the Beatle records. All that time, EMI Capitol had the rights to them. They just didn't act on them. Same thing was happening. It's happening today, too. When you sign an international deal, it doesn't mean you're going to be released in every territory.
Well, the lag between the U.S. and the
U.K. was crazy.
The U.K. release was just ridiculous. It's sometimes 6 to 8 months.
There was also a materialistic reason for that, too. If you are the company that signs the artist, you make much more money. So American companies wanted to put their artists out, not foreign artists out, because they'd have to pay extra fees to the companies that were the actual owners.
Also, there was 12-inch versions of singles that you had extra remixes on it and so forth that you wouldn't be able to get here.
Yeah, which was part of the amazing club scene that was going on then. And that was really, that kind of grew out of the disco scene, too. You know, where there were disco mixes in England that people couldn't get, even though they were done in Chicago. I mean, but it was part of what made it cool then, because there was something about being unique about it. It was an amazing time.
So give me some other great stories from behind the scenes.
Well, when I was on Punky Reggae Party, Dennis gave me songs to play. We found songs. Dennis sent me to England to look for songs.
I told everyone that went to England, bring me back songs. Right? I'd always say, bring
Dennis
me back
said,
songs.
Go to this guy and meet Richard Scott. He's in Rough Trade. He'll have a package for you. And Richard Scott would say I was a hopeless colonist because I couldn't play chess. One of the I don't know who came up with Pass the Dutchie. That was I don't even remember. There was so many
people. I know it was signed eventually to MCA, right?
But, I mean, we brought it in as an import.
Yes.
And who gave us Down Under with Who Can It Be Now?
Well, that was an Australian import. That was a 45 from somewhere.
But was it an English recording?
It was an English one.
They couldn't get a deal in Australia.
Really? Well, you know what? Once they had the Sony deal, they had a worldwide deal. Yeah, so then they were everywhere.
These are songs that I was playing. First of all, only white guy playing these songs on a reggae show at Sunday night. Dennis told me that I had the only formatted reggae show in the country because that's what his consultant told him.
I didn't know you were a white guy.
Well, a lot of people didn't.
But
Dennis had me follow the formula of L.A.R.'s Dare to Be Different formula so that we had
A's, right.
B's,
had
C's,
A's, and B's.
B's
and C's. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And we even did the big spliff of the week. And big spliff of the week could sometimes get into the screamer of the week, which was cool.
That was pretty cool. Titus High was one of those, right? Blondie, Titus High.
Let's talk about the screamer of the week. How did that originate and who thought of it?
You know what?
No one knows.
I came up with an idea based upon, Screamer of the Week, it's hard to say who came up with the real name for it. A number of people claim it. It was originally intended to be a record of the week that we would champion and would be declared by John DiBella on the John DiBella Morning Show. Then we disagreed about it, and I made it into a fan voting thing. I didn't want it to just be limited to one show. I wanted it to be on Thursdays. Thursdays were the start of the ratings when the rating diaries went out. I wanted to do something incredibly special on Thursday nights. It's because if the diary got filled out on a Thursday night, it was a good chance it got turned in, and we had because we were an 18 to 24 based ratings dominance at that point in time. I mean dominance. We were in great danger of people not turning in their diaries because they don't even give in their term papers, you know. So the long story short was I wanted something great, and it was really something that once we got the idea of a song of the week, I thought, no, it's got to be a little bit, I didn't use the term interactive, but that's, I wanted something that the listeners would vote for. So it'd be kind of like the old-fashioned top 40, top 10 of 10s or whatever, even though a lot of those were just fixed. But I wanted real audience feedback, and I wanted to make it where all the DJs could participate so they could do the picks. And it was really, a lot of it was Dick Clark. Remember Dick Clark used to have... Yeah, you know, it was the Dick Clark thing of, like, yeah, we'll give it an 80, you know, or whatever. But there was a guy on the Ted Mack Amateur Hour. People have been doing it for years. And, of course, American Idol was, you know, kind of another variation on it. But Screamer of the Week, just people loved it because it was honest, you know. It was like us really...
Yeah, I voted for that song. That's my song.
And the artists would get so into it. You see that in the movie. But, I mean, Joey Ramone would be like, I can't believe we won, man. This is the greatest. And it was just, you know what, it was a badge of honor for the bands to wave.
And, oh, sure.
And basically, it helped sell records like crazy, which was, you know what, it was a good thing, and I was always proud of it, but our intention was just to make people listen and have fun. I mean, and we always wanted to support our bands. It was another way to support our bands, because if we were nominating them, that meant we really dug the band or the artist, you know. You wouldn't be picking something... They used to fight about them. I used to have to break up fights all the time between these grown-up DJs. Because I had that song first. No, I saw it. I wrote it in before you. People would come in and write the song down, and somebody would cross theirs off and then write the same song in somewhere else. So I had to, like, put in, you know, a principle of the high school kind of rules to do it right. But people loved it, and, you know, it became, then it went to the clubs and the screamer parties and all
that.
It was a badge of honor to be connected to.
It manifested to a point where everyone had their screamer pick as a promo, so that all through the daytime clock, you'd hear a promo for the guys that...
Well, that was to generate voting, but also it was to put comic stuff on in the middle of our music thing and personality stuff.
And also let everyone hear the...
It was a little bit of an SNL, you know, Saturday Night Live.
It was a way of having everyone hear the screamer
picks. Yeah, it was like doing it was like an election commercial.
How many songs were in a screamer competition? How many did you have?
How many what?
How many songs were in a screamer competition?
Anywhere from 7 to 10. We might have even gotten up to 12, but you know what? When it got really big like that, it was like a horse race, you know? You get rid of five of them right away because they don't have a prayer. But, no, and you know what? It was a way sometimes to champion a small, unknown artist, you know, and give them their chance. And, of course, the worst thing would be to put your small, unknown artist out the week that U2, Duran Duran, and Depeche Mode all had new songs coming out. But it was fun. We did break a lot of artists that way, and it became a big banner thing.
About your three song formula for a band.
Well, I tell Epi this all the time.
Let's hear it. I want
to
hear it.
They have to, that if we're booking bands, they have to have three screamers of the week. Because any band that got to the point where they had three screamers of the week suddenly could build a following. That could build a following that you'd want to go see them in concert. Because I don't know why three was the right number, but it was. Because it works so much.
Take a band like...
One is a one-hit wonder. Two is, okay, you got a second one in there. Three is, this is a band you get serious
about.
It's
a band that
means... You know what? It's the difference back then of an album having only two good songs, or the third song would say it's a great album. You know,
it's a band 40 years later called APB that means nothing anywhere else in the country because no other radio station played them. Yet they had three Screamers of the Week here.
Yeah, and they might have more.
They can still sell tickets today. Even though it's so many years later because of the three songs.
Yeah, they come and they sell out in New York and they sell out in Long Island and then they go back to Scotland.
Yeah, that's their tour. How about the guys that were camped out in the motel rooms listening for Screamer Pick, for the Screamer of the Week, who won and what they would do? They'd go sign the act, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There was like, well, there were a lot of bands signed off of us. I remember I had the import from Canada of Katrina and the Waves, Walking on Sunshine. I played it on a Sunday night. It was signed on the Monday.
Wow.
You know, we put it on the import show, and by that Monday, Capitol had signed it. I remember the publisher called me and said, look, I owe you one because you played this song last night, and I just got the publishing for it and stuff like that.
Is that another one? I mean,
99 Luft Balloons. Yeah,
I remember
German
that song,
import.
Yeah.
You know what? People said to all of these foreign record companies, nobody will ever listen to non-English language records in America. And to a large degree, they were right, but Nana 99 Luft Balloons, we had Peter Schilling, Major Tom in German. We had Plastic Bertrand, C'est plein pour moi.
Yeah,
I mean, which was, we had the Commissar by Falco.
I was going to mention that.
Yeah, we played all of these wacky songs. And you know what? When I was a kid, there were all kinds of crazy songs from other countries that got played. And then for some reason that stopped. But, you know, Sukiyaki was a huge hit in the 60s, if you go and look it up. And some of these other things. And they were fun records. And I think that, you know, people don't realize how much available great music is in these countries that don't happen to speak English. I mean, there's some great stuff going on there. Actually, you know what? I know the Scottish can only speak English. I don't know what they're saying. And I mean, we had a lot of Scottish hits too.
Didn't Bananarama have a foreign song? It's like the last song on their greatest hits album is a song that's not in English. And it's a great tune. It's a great tune.
Got me.
We'll look it up on the internet after we're done. But
that the song "Talking Italian"?
No, that's like track 8. This is like track 14.
"Talking Italian." I remember speaking of Bananarama, they had put out a single with Robert De Niro in it.
Yeah, that's his thing. "Talking Italian," Robert De Niro. "Talking Italian."
So I'm on the air, and we were the only ones playing it because we got the import from Seth. Roger Ames was really mad at me because he was looking for you. Roger was their president of their company, okay. And a lovely man. And I kid because I love Roger. But nonetheless, we get a phone call in the office, and the music director comes running in, and she says to me, Robert De Niro's people are on the phone. And they want to know if you could play the song this afternoon at a certain time so Robert could hear it. So I said, can I just talk to them just to, you know, I want to make sure. And sure enough, it's real. You know, they're down at Miramax or wherever. And they said they have a radio there because, it was tricky in the village. And I said, well, are you sure you can get it up? And they said, sure you can get the reception on it? And they said, sure. And then I said, well, why don't you do this? When Robert gets there, call me and tell me, and then I'll play it for him. So they called me. So I went on the air and I said, and this is for Robert De Niro, who wants to hear his song about himself or something like that. But it never called back, so I don't think he really liked it that much.
Well, the song was called Robert De Niro's Waiting.
Yeah, that's it.
And the foreign song is I Wanna.
Good.
But there you go.
That's good to know.
But yeah, it's a great album, by the way. You know. So what, Epi, give me some of the great stories. Or intros to great stories.
And you can go on and on. There's so many different genres. I wanted to ask Dennis if he can go back in his Ablamandula and remember first, you know, when he became music director, and he's out there and he's getting ready to do his first live radio broadcast. Does he remember where it was, who it was?
Oh, sure. When I was running WNYU, I went on stage briefly when the WNEW-FM staff had set up a benefit to get us some equipment. And it was David Bromberg at Town Hall in Manhattan. But then the first one I did out here was probably at my father's place.
Because it would have probably 73 been... 73 or 74?
No, it was 74.
So we were at Ultrasonic later. By 74.
Yeah, no, we were at Ultrasonic. So, I'm not sure what the first one I did at my father's place was. Because in the beginning...
The first concert we did at my father's place was Bruce Springsteen. But Cole...
Yes, that was Kenny Cole that did that, yeah. And the first one I did, you know, as music director was Tommy Bolin. Because I remember, and then there were a bunch of them in there, and we probably split them up. But,
you know, Dennis...
I loved introducing
them. But while Dennis is thinking about this, you know, the things that Dennis did that were brilliant, aside from the fact that Screamer of the Week was brilliant, that he got the entire audience to interact, but beside from that, what I wanted to say was he would bring those two guys that were on Second City from the Great White North.
Oh, yeah.
At 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock in the
we
morning.
We did it at 12 noon. Yeah. And we did it as a lunch, a midnight snack at lunch or whatever, because we used to have a show, Midnight Snack. And DiBello went over there and emceed it with the Second City guys.
The entire audience.
I didn't find out till years later, because a friend of mine knew one of the guys from Second City. That they had no idea they were walking into that. Apparently, the record guys didn't quite fill them in on the thing that John DiBella had imagined. So that makes it even more amazing how great it was.
The record company came over in the morning and they took all my Molson cases and set them up on the stage.
They did the set from the TV show. It was amazing.
That's pretty funny.
And then we did an afternoon concert where they would talk to me. I never met them. They would talk to me as the jock on the air from my father's place, from the stage.
Did they have the flappy hats?
They had everything. It was amazing. You know, that reminds me. One time, Billy Joel had a charity for a while where he was helping out kids
charity
on Long Island.
Charity Begins at Home.
And we announced the beginning of the series where we were raising money for it from the basement of my father's place. And we had to be there to do it because I guess it was going around the country at like 9 or 10 in the morning because it was going to be on morning shows all over America. And there's Billy in there, you know, dressed up nice and everything, playing some stuff from the scenes from an Italian restaurant.
Was that when he played piano on my stage?
Yeah, he played piano on the stage. We did this announcement, and then Billy and I were going to get our photos taken with some record store executives over on the Miracle Mile. So Billy had just gotten his driver's license, and he had that green Mercedes, and he wasn't a terribly good driver at that point because he was still, you know, he was probably on his permit or whatever. So we go over, you know, we pull out of my father's place, cut around and go up there, and on one of the turns, I mean, Billy, like, ran the light a little or something like that, and anyway, this other car comes hurtling at us, and he does some movement, he goes, shoo, and all I'm thinking afterwards is, famous rock star and local DJ.
News at 11.
Yeah, news at 11, exactly. But Billy, I must add, in case he's listening, got much better driving. I know the motorcycle was a different thing.
Why don't you tell your story about driving some people to OHOP and later finding out.
Oh, this is Dennis's show. We'll save that for another day.
It's Richard's show.
Yeah, this is a free-for-all.
That's all right. When I took Live Aid winners to England, They started getting bored because all of the LIR bands had played, and even though I kind of wanted to see Queen, we were really getting tired. It was a long, long day, and we had seen all the great ones. And Seth was with us, or you were there that day. You were helping me on the other side. So I called him. We ended up buying all these beers and everything, and we went to the hotel, and we had a big party and watched the U.S. side of Live Aid. I don't know. Do you remember that? And no, some guy, there was a guy that worked for you that took us, Tony took us, because he worked with some other band. I can't remember.
The Furs.
I can remember. Okay. But Tony, I love Tony. We went to Tony's house and we partied. And these kids, they went, you know, they just went to see the biggest concert in the world. They're flying, you know, to England. They're hanging around with me like they think I know what I'm doing. And I'm like counting on Seth for everything. And then we end up, and afterwards they went, the greatest thing was like partying with real British people in the house. And I'm like, okay, whatever, you know. And I got them back alive, which was really important.
The story that Seth wanted me to tell, I'll tell Richard's audience, was that in the early days of my father's play, 72, we did the touring company of the National Lampoon show. And it was the National Lampoon touring show, and it was a Sunday night. I had just moved to the North Shore from Rockville Center. I didn't know about the trains. I knew it was a Roslyn train, but because of all the blue bloods that lived on the North Coast, North Shore, the train stopped Sunday night at 12 midnight because it was a diesel. And everyone had a ride home from the cast except for three kids, and it was a blizzard out. And I didn't know that there was a train in Hicksville. There was a train in Port Washington. And I just thought, oh, there's no train. So I jumped in the car with these three kids and drove to OHOP, 17 Mott Street. We ate. They were delightful. There was a girl holding hands with a guy in the back, and then there was a guy in the front. Years later, George Lucas, not from Star Wars, George Lucas, who owned U.S. Blues, calls me up and goes, "App, I hope you don't mind." I invited, I had that night the James Cotton Blues Band playing, and James Cotton's guitar player was Matt Guitar Murphy.
Love him.
He said, I invited...
Wasn't he with the Blues Brothers at one point?
Well, this is the story I'm telling you.
That's where he's going.
This is the dawn of it. That George says, I have everyone over from Saturday Night Live. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. Saturday Night Live was over, and then they were out there, and they were just jamming. And Matt Guitar Murphy was going to teach the Aykroyds and the Belushis how to do blues. And he said, I hope you don't mind.
Wow.
I said, no, my show's over. I did 2 sold-out shows. So just bring a vial and bring a couple of your bimbettes over. And I went over there, and Belushi is introduced to me. I'm introduced to Belushi from this guy George Lucas, and he has clammy hands. I remember the clear, and George says, "There's the guy who owns that of the club." Oh man, I gigged your club when I moved here from Chicago. You turned me on to my favorite Chinese restaurant, man. I go, Mr. Belushi, I've never had dinner with you, let alone. hang out. He said, no. So I said, who else was in the car? Because he said he played the Lampoon show.
Yeah.
So after he said that, I said, who else was in the car tonight? He says, Ratner and Murray.
My God. I'll tell you, I have a segue to that. I'm at the rock and roll, R&R, the Radio and Records Convention. It was a big music convention back in the 70s. And this is my first one. I'm out in L.A., and the Blues Brothers are playing. Now, LIR broke the Blues Brothers. There's a party afterwards, and it's all the program directors from around the country, from all the AOR stations. And everybody's going to meet, have a picture taken with Danny and with John, dressed as the Blues Brothers. And this guy comes over, Roy Rosenberg, nice guy. He was the Atlantic rep, and he comes over, he said, Dennis, John Belushi needs to talk to you right away. So I thought, is this some kind of joke? Because no, he wants to meet you personally. So I walk over, and Belushi is like, you run WLIR? I love WLIR. And then he announces, he goes, what's your name? Dennis McNamara. Of course, I know that. He goes, hold on, everybody in the room. This guy runs a real radio station. He goes, and then Danny, come meet Dennis. This guy does great radio and stuff like that. And Danny's like, hey, good to meet you. And I'm like, holy cow, I'm getting out of here. Because you can imagine all these other radio are always trying to get, blah, 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 like the jealousy factor. How'd he pull that one off, And I mean, it was nice of the guy to do it, everything. And I was like, wow. And then for the rest of the week, I'd see them, walking around, Paul Schaefer, all of them, like, Dennis! Like that. It was amazing.
So, Epi.
Yes.
Give me some more stuff.
I mean, we should do another show with all this stuff and format it out because, you want to be able to think of put together all the good stuff.
Yeah, and also, if you put together this stuff, like just John Belushi stuff alone, I got caught in an elevator going to a party for Dolly Parton. Where I was supposed to say hello to Mick Jagger. How does that sound so far?
It sounds amazing to me.
I'm on an elevator in the World Trade Center. The party's at the top of the World Trade Center.
Windows
on
the world.
There's a pile of us in that elevator going up, and it stops. And we're all looking around at each other. And Belushi says, hey, folks, don't worry. Ron Delsner's on the elevator. Nothing can happen to us.
Was Ron on the elevator?
Yeah, Ron was on the elevator. It was just like that.
I just want to do one ending story, just so you should have this. You two, Dennis really mentored you two. No one wanted to play the record except for WLIR for some reason. And Dennis really was on it and picked out the songs and was rectified years later. I met Bono at when I was on tour with Burning Spear, and I was at the Portobello Hotel in Stanley Gardens.
Oh, I love the Portobello. I stayed there on many an occasion.
Which room? I like the round room.
I don't know. I never remembered what rooms I had.
The beauty about the Portobello Hotel is
in 24-hour bar.
Right. In England, you can't eat after 10 o'clock at night anywhere. Not in the city.
There's lots of the lands down there.
Oh, yeah.
And,
I love the Portobello bar because you never knew what rock star you're going to meet, but you were going to meet
one. So I'm actually sitting there with Bono and Malcolm McLaren and with who was one other person? Oh, Patti Smith. Richie Havens, I don't remember. But Bono said to me, as Richie came up, says, Dennis McNamara can play any instrument on in any city in the world with us.
He actually did say that to me.
He said that to me.
He came up to me. I was with them in Boston. I was working closely with Island Records, even though I was part of Polydor Records. And my boss tells you what a lovely guy he was. He said, you know, you should just go off with you two for a day or two and take it easy. You've been stressed. And I went with the president of Island up, and we went with the band in the limos. Bono stopped all the state troopers so he could wave at the fans from the side of the road. And then he was riding in front of us. It was me, Paul McGinnis, their manager, and Johnny Barbas, who was the president of Island at the time. And in front of us, Bono was with one of these famous actresses pretending he's making out behind and doing all these things for us. Then we get to the Patriots Stadium, Foxborough, and it's like nuts. I mean, it's 70,000 screaming people. And we get inside, and at some point, I'm walking with Johnny, and Bono comes running up, and he said, you guys, now, anything you want to do tonight, anywhere you want to be, you want to stay on stage with us, you want to do this and that, and I'm like, oh, that's okay, and he said, but right now, I'd spend more time with you, but I want to go out and talk to the punters. He turns around, walks like about 6 feet up and goes through the security gate, and the next thing we hear is screaming people outside because the Messiah has just got out to hang out with the kids. It was just the most amazing thing. And then later on we had a party, and it was a funny party because, you know, we're drinking like Irishmen and everything. It's about 4 a.m. and we were at the Four Seasons Hotel in Boston, and all of a sudden I feel this hand on my shoulder, and Bono is just does one of these, Dennis McNamara, you've always brought us good karma. Walks away, and I'm like, wow, the Pope just anointed me or something like that. But, I mean, that was pretty amazing, I have to admit. And you know what? I went under the stage and saw the Edge's guitars, because he has like a guitar for every song, Edge, you know, already tuned up and ready to go. It was just friggin' amazing thing to do. So, yeah, I'm very grateful to them for acknowledging me. That's fine by me.
These are just really wonderful stories. These are just phenomenal.
We'll do another show with everyone.
Yeah. All righty. I appreciate, for those listening to this special bonus, thanks for listening, and we'll catch you on the airwaves.
Right, and our lawyers will be in touch.
Hey, wait, I am a lawyer.
But